Hello, I'm Tim Rogers with Kotaku.com. I'm here today talking to
Edmund McMillen.
Danielle McMillen.
That's two people with the same last name. You may know Edmund McMillen as one of the developers, the designer. What's the, we didn't settle on a job title pre-show.
I'll take all the credit. I'm the guy.
He's the guy who made single-handedly, that's a joke, the game The Binding of Isaac, which is like a procedurally generated Zelda for people who love naked babies, turds, and blood. That's my how I would pitch that game to someone.
It's you a also good pitch.
You also made that you bought with your own hands by yourself Super Meat Boy as well, right?
Exclusively.
That was you, right?
I don't even know anymore.
That's a joke. I know that was you, and I know that you made it by yourself. I was there. I saw the movie. Okay. I saw the movie. So whatever. So you're on Kickstarter now, as of this interview going up, possibly a few minutes ago. You launched a Kickstarter, right?
Yep.
And it's for
The Binding of Isaac, four souls,
and that's not four as in the conjunction four, that is the number four. There are four souls. The goal of the game is to get four souls. You're going to tell us all about this game, so let's start by asking a few questions that we did not rehearse in advance, so we're going to be very surprised by this. I've noticed, and our readers have noticed, and everybody always, when they hear Kickstarter, they go, whoa, Kickstarter. I've been burned by Kickstarter before. Everybody has. Being burned by Kickstarter is as common as having had the chicken pox, you know? So I've noticed stuff that does really well on Kickstarter tends to be card games, board games, tabletop games, physical games that are design complete and like ready to go pretty much. So right at the top, I want to ask, how done is your game?
95. Well, the design is about 95% done. I mostly need the time and money for the artists to kind of finish it. We got a good amount of art done for the Kickstarter itself, so you can kind of see how it looks. But it's pretty fucking done. Like it's, I wouldn't have even considered it if it wasn't.
So it's like it's you were telling me you have something like 300 some cards, right?
Yeah.
So that's a lot of cards. And as with any card game, the bulk of the work is designing this game so that all the cards jive together and work, right?
Yeah.
So the game works. And you are someone who has played a lot of card games. You've kickstarted several card games, probably, right?
Well, Kingdom Death has cards in it, and I did kickstart that. I put a lot of money into that one. And that game is fucking great. There's a bird that sucks you into his anus and makes you erase from time.
And that's just the kind of conversation that you probably wish to inspire with your own card game, is that right?
Of course. Why wouldn't you?
So you're saying you need this money on this Kickstarter. You need that hot, filthy Kickstarter money.
I need it. I need a good amount of the money. Mostly, I want to make sure that people get the shit that's up there. I mean, it makes it a lot easier to have this stuff printed and shipped, like a one-stop shop.
Yeah. So that's how much money is this Kickstarter for? What's your thing?
I think the goal is 50 grand.
50 grand. And you're probably going to have passed that by noon or so. I don't want to speak for you. I don't want to put you on the spot. Oh, you're going to do just fine. It's going to be okay.
I'm excited.
Yeah, see? You're excited.
It feels a lot like the Meat Boy release, where it was like people are telling me good things, but man, that was rough in the beginning.
I have published numerous video games myself in the past, and everyone who had played them told me, "You're gonna be so rich, dude." Now I have a job making videos about video games. So, a job. I didn't want a job.
I.
I see what this is going to turn into.
That's enough of that. You're not going to need to get a job. I think you're going to be okay. Again, I don't want to say too much.
I hope I get a job.
I don't want to jinx you. Okay, I don't want to jinx you. So let's say you're making this game, and tell me about the development of this game. Like, where did it come from? What's the idea? So you were telling me that a studio came to you at some point in the past, in the hazy past. You want to tell me about that?
A studio that claimed to be huge Binding of Isaac fans contacted me, and they were like, "Hey, what would you ever consider licensing the Isaac IP?" And I'm like, "No."
Goodbye.
Like, wait, did you say no? Did you give them a no?
Well, yeah, no, I said no. I said I wouldn't be interested in doing anything like that unless I was the designer of whatever it was.
Okay.
And they're like, "Well, you know, what would you be interested in doing, a board game?" And I was like, "Well, if I had an idea for a board game."
So they came to you and they didn't actually have an idea?
Well, they may have.
Yeah.
I should have asked so I could have it.
Oh, maybe you shouldn't have asked, because, you know, that way you have plausible deniability. They can't legally say you stole their idea if you decided to do it yourself.
I used their idea.
Right.
You know damn well.
Whatever their idea was, you definitely weren't going to use it.
Danielle was thinking that it was Yahtzee. Isaac Yahtzee. Mm.
The Binding of Yahtzak?
Yeah.
Is that what they were going to call it? Let's not ever say that word again. I think it's it's probably a bad word somewhere.
Somebody's going to make an Isaac Yahtzee after.
She's all about this now. She like made a mock-up of like a Binding of Isaac Yahtzee, and now she's like, "Well, people do seem like they like the idea."
They do like it.
Yeah, okay.
It's
we'll print enough dice for the Kickstarter.
It's
going to
be a hot topic by the end of the year.
Binding of Isaac Yahtzee.
I don't think it would be in hot topic by the end of the year. I do, however, think it would be in Yahtzopic by the end of the year. That's my that's my joke about that.
Get out.
Yeah, there we go. Okay, I'm gonna go home now. Bye. So this studio came to you. They didn't have an idea, or you didn't ask, and they wanted you to basically.
I'm sure they were full of tons of great ideas. They're a great studio.
Well, they're obviously smart people if they are able to claim that they are Binding of Isaac fans. They're obviously very into it. So basically, what they wanted was, would you say this phrasing is correct? They wanted your blessing to put some guys on it. Is that it?
I would say, yeah, the initial pitch was put some guys on it.
They thought they would get you to sign a paper, and then they would say, all right, we're going to make a game, and they would get a think tank together, and they would come up with something like that.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, it was the straight bait of the Isaac.
Oh,
put some guys on it.
Okay, nice. So you told them, you said no, right?
Yeah, I wasn't mean about it, because they did seem like genuine Isaac fans, and like seems like a cool idea for sure, but like I'm not gonna do something unless I know that like I have an idea for it, I'm invested in it, I'm excited about it. And I was doing a million other things at the time, and it was a shitty time in general. Yeah. And it was my low point, and I said no.
And you looked into these dudes, and they seemed legit.
Oh yeah. They did they had just finished up the Joking Hazard Kickstarter, and they seemed to know what they're fucking talking about, and they had done toys, and they represent the Rock.
They represent the Rock in what capacity?
I don't even know. They have a picture of him on their website.
they wear Dwayne Johnson t-shirts.
Yeah.
That's representation, right? That's I don't know, man. Any affiliation with the Rock, I would have immediately said, "Yes, please." And I would have rolled over, and then, you know, I would have gotten taken for a ride. So you're stronger than I am. So what happened was, what happened after this?
Time passed.
Time passed. How much time?
Like a year. Time passed. I released The End Is Nigh, so that was done. I've been still working on Legend of Bumbo, so I was still working on a project, but I got a horrible flu from our baby.
Oh, babies do that to you.
Yeah.
You know what babies do? They take a disease.
Well, listen,
that's a conversation for the economists in the audience. What babies do is they take a disease that we can't even perceive, that our immune system doesn't know anything about, that our immune system has been immune to forever. They take it, and within the baby, the disease thrives, right? And it multiplies, and it becomes strong. And then the baby, in its sneezes and exhalations, puts a stronger version of that disease out into your house. And that makes you sick.
And that's right? That's why you don't vax your kids. Right? That's the general argument. We have friends who are anti-vaxxers, and my head exploded during a dinner with them. I love them as people. I really do. And I'm not going to be one of those people who are like, you're an idiot, blah, 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 blah. But I had to at least explain, like, the possibility. It's like, oh, well, there's no smallpox around. It's, you know, it's going to cause autism. And it's like, no. Number one, no. And then you can go to autismspeaks.com and you can look and you can see the official autism website says so. But let's just go back to the whole smallpox thing. There's a chance that if your kid does, it will change and then we will all get it.
Exactly. That's what children do.
That's what they do. That's what they are here for making things worse.
They turn tiny diseases into huge diseases.
They're a converter of horribleness.
So you were sick with this this monster baby flu.
I didn't vaccinate, and I was sick with I was sick with some form of autism, and I decided that I was going to sit on the couch. And I was bored, and I was, I think I had played some, I drafted online, some Magic, and I was just not feeling it.
You love Magic? You like Magic?
I love Magic.
How's that?
I actually worked for Wizards of the Coast to design a card. They did that, like, developer designs thing for, like, their last core set, which wasn't the last core set, and, it was like me and Notch. George Fan, creator of Plants vs. Zombies, and I think like the Penny Arcade guys and some other folks.
That sounds like a real crew.
Yeah.
You guys walking down the street.
Yeah. Fucking fedoras blazing.
Yeah. So, against the wall with one leg up.
So you're drafting some Magic and you're just like, you know what is what you said? Did you just suddenly speak? You just look
I
at
stood
your,
up. I stood up in like in a haze.
And he slapped me across the face.
I said, shut up! I'm thinking. And then I had the idea, and I was like, Binding of Isaac card game. I had a rough idea of like how to implement what the Binding of Isaac, what it has going for it. You know, the random generation, the rooms, the monsters, and the item combinations and stuff like that. I took those elements, and I was like, wait a minute, like I could kind of like wrap this into a card game, and I could rework, you know, all the mechanics of the bosses that make the bosses unique, and I could find, you know, once I come up with the language of the cards, I can kind of speak to the theme of each item and each character and each boss, and that was exciting in itself. And I tend to do this sort of stuff, like, well, I'll design a game basically start to finish on paper and realize it just I'm not feeling it, or it's just not as good as it, you know, and just put it away. Yeah. But this was one of those ones that it could have been like that. And but it was an interesting enough idea for me to want to actually make a prototype for it, a physical prototype. So you
went to, obviously, the way one of these card games starts is, and I've done this before. You get index cards, right?
Yeah.
And that's what you did.
Yep, I got 400 index cards, blank index cards, and I got a pen.
Oh, no. How many colors of pen? Just one pen?
It was one pen. Black Bic pen.
It's kept it simple.
Yeah.
Now,
and
okay.
I went to town.
Pop quiz. What was the name of the store where you bought the index cards?
It was called the Palace of Fine Arts.
It is called Palace Fine Arts.
It's better when you put the.
I don't know why you're calling it that.
The Palace.
Palace Fine Arts? Or Palace Arts? The Palace of, so the Palace of Fine Arts.
It's called
is a,
Palace Art Supply.
Yeah, okay.
Palace of Fine Arts.
I've just found it. It's Palace Art and Office Supply. However,
oh my God.
It's in Santa Cruz, California.
Is there a picture of me going in?
No, there's a picture of a lady who looks overjoyed to be putting stickers onto a notebook. So
it's probably me.
Yeah, I'm gonna. It could. I mean, you know, at this point, it's kind of hard to say. So it's they've got 65 reviews, a 3.5 on Yelp. Top review says, "I also bought 6 2.5 fluid ounce tubes of acrylic paint." So.
I did almost get in a fight with a guy in this place once.
Oh, no. So you called it, do people colloquially refer to it as the Palace of Fine Arts? Because
I do.
That's a famous monument in the city of San Francisco. not an art supply store. Art and office.
I can call them right now and say, "Is this the Palace of Fine Arts?" And they will not correct me.
I think that we're getting old, so like we call CVS Longs.
Ever been to Alpha Beta?
And things like that. No one is going to get that.
I call CVS CVs. So,
CVs.
I mean, I actually do.
I go into CVS, refer to it as Longs, and ask if they have Rite Aid brand allergy pills.
Oh,
and
yeah.
You have done that.
Yeah, I have done that. And they go, we have a CVS brand.
Oh, no.
And I said, "You mean Longs? Fuck off."
Oh, no. All the drugstores should just get together. You know, just make.
How exactly does Rite Aid that is now Rite Aid, that used to be Thrifty, still have a Thrifty ice cream booth in it?
There's, in New York City, we have Dwayne Reed, which is, first of all, just a guy's name. That's weird. And then it's just a singular. It's not even like an apostrophe S. Yes. And then we have Walgreens. And then we have, but Dwayne Reed owns all the Walgreens. So sometimes you find Walgreens products. And enough of that. You bought index cards and you you prototyped the game on index cards. So wait, this is just a minor curiosity. Prior to prototyping the game on index cards, how did the prototype exist? Did you write it out on paper? Did you make a spreadsheet?
I have a little sketchbook that I got from the Palace of Fine Arts.
Oh yeah,
it's a little brown one. It's and
did a tour guide walk up and give it to you?
Yes, he was a very nice gentleman.
Yeah.
So I mostly just sketched down tons of different random ideas on there. So I probably sketched up a bunch of like probably templating stuff and just general ideas of like how to simulate the different occurrences and stuff like that. And then from there I had enough going on. I eventually moved to Google Spreadsheets, which I'm loving.
Oh, yeah.
It is my jam right now.
That's
I am all about it.
That's where I prototype all of my card games that I never
I've been out of the loop.
About.
Like, whenever I say that to people, they're like, "Yeah, dude. Yeah, that's all I do." It's like, why didn't you tell me?
So once
I've been fucking using Notepad.
It's good. It does all the stuff that Excel does. Whenever somebody like emails me an XLS, I'm just like, what?
yeah. I didn't do the same thing. I was like, how am I supposed to, what? Like, I'm supposed to own this?
Can you just make this a Google Sheet, dude, and send it back to me, is what I usually say. So you from the Google Sheet, you look at it. You look at the numbers, and you go, I'm going to put this on index cards. And you ended up on that step?
Where yeah.
And at that point, index cards, kind of rough art, some, you know, scrawled in big pen, and you play test it, obviously.
Yeah, me and Danielle sit down. We use we have this little, it's our go-to table right now, but really it's supposed to be a little gymnastics-type square for our daughter.
But it has a cutout so you can crawl through, which she likes to do when there's stuff on top of it
and
throw
up.
Everything.
But we played it on that, so this is like
soft. And
she soft.
Was taking a nap, so it was safe. She was not there to fuck anything up.
Yeah.
It was
a soft little square that we played the game on, and
I'm going to need a photograph of this table.
There is a photograph on the Kickstarter right now.
Well, shoot.
Of the prototype being played on said table.
And I believe you've already sent me that, and I'm looking at it right now. So you play it, and it's a two-player game?
It was at that point. I didn't have any other people to play with.
And now it's a four-player game. Did you like how I asked that question as though I didn't know the answer already?
Yeah, it was good.
Yeah, that's acting classes.
You're a regular Dwayne Johnson.
Yeah, exactly. tell the studio to call me up. Make my dreams come true. So you played the game. It worked. It was fun. It was good.
Yeah, even though it was very primitive, it was amazing. Like Danielle's mentioned before, like, it's amazing what rolling dice, like how fun rolling dice can be at times, especially when you're gambling on things, basically.
Yeah. Now I understand the whole people gathered around, squatting down on the sidewalk, rolling the dice.
Yeah.
That's illegal.
And why is that illegal? Fun is illegal?
Yeah.
Rolling dice is beautiful, and it should be legal for everyone. So you're playing this game, and it worked, and it was good. And what did you do then? How many cards? How many cards were there in this prototype?
In the prototype, probably about 200, I think.
Just about. Wow, that's a lot. So you.
Yeah, I didn't have like ratios and stuff worked out. I didn't know like how many of this card you need for, you know, resource management sort of situation. So that was the main issue that I had, that I needed to kind of see on paper in front of me, like, you know, what percentage of these cards are going to be bosses, which percentage are these cards going to be random happenings and monsters and items, that sort of stuff. But then I was like, okay, this works, this is fun, and this would be probably a lot more fun if I design it around four people, because then you get more of like a social backstabby cooperative type experience,
more of a party atmosphere, yeah. In other words.
Exactly. In order to do that, I needed to like make more professional cards, because in the few times we tested it after that, it was like, how the fuck do you shuffle index cards? It sucks. Like, shuffling index cards sucks. So I went and got a little like was it at Kinko's? Where did I go? Office Max.
Office Max.
This woman at Office Max, she's great.
Well, first we went to Kinko's where there was an alcoholic man.
Oh yeah, that guy reeked. He tried to help me and he failed. He kept telling me to, like, you just do this. And then he presses like five or six different buttons. And I'm like,
I remember being impressed and thinking, okay, well, he's an alcoholic, but he can come to work and he really knows what he's doing with the copy machine.
Yeah, he did know what he's doing, but he didn't inform me of what it was. It was like, oh, you press these five buttons. This thing opens up on the side and a different paper size in it. Then you put it in this way and it does that. So that was unsuccessful. I fucked up that one. So I ended up going to Office Max, and this woman helped me with the templates that I had made. I made them in Flash.
And they
still using Flash.
Oh, you gotta love Flash.
Yeah, and then they printed them out for me on little label stickers, and the label stickers are just about the size of a playing card. So I had a bunch of Magic card commons that I just had from drafts in the past, and I used those, stuck them on there, sleeved them up. And invited some friends over, and we ate pizza and played The Binding of Isaac Four Souls.
And it was overall a good time.
Yeah, it was a surprisingly good time. Social situations are, like, social games are just so fucking different from digital. As you know, how lonely it is to work on a game for ages, only to not know exactly how people feel about it when you release it. And you never see joy. You never see, like, we have streamers now, which is great. But most of those people put on a mask when they go on and they say and do their little dance.
They wear their sunglasses, like, and their wig and their fake mustache and all of that stuff.
But
you don't know who.
With this, it's like such a genuine experience. And like, it was just super cool, super inspiring. It made me really want to like double down on it and flesh it out and tune it and make it work.
I had a particularly dark variant of like a hybrid of the two experiences of digital and social, because I was working on a local multiplayer game.
Yeah.
And there's a whole lot of little tiny things. You're balancing the game based on experiences you've had with people, you know, like people actually playing the game live. So you end up balancing and tweaking and tuning the game pretty much in the dark, versus that experience of actually seeing the joy. So every time you see joy, it's coupled with, well, now I'm going to have to sit an extra hour in the dark to ensure that this joy is deeper. To deepen this joy.
It's the instant gratification from doing something physical. Like, I don't have to interact with a programmer.
Yeah.
I literally just do the change on paper and it's done. Or many times it's just, hey, the rules are different now. Now all the items cost 10 coins. Play.
Yeah.
Like, it's not an issue.
So I didn't realize how much I would like it.
Yeah.
Oh, how much usually, you would like?
Well, how much I would like this development experience? Because like Tyler is amazing. He's you know, the Tyler Glale who had made Bend Is Nigh With and what other things?
Ether. And he also put the Basement Collection together and
that guy.
He's great, but usually, like, it's just like me and Ed have this relationship, and then all of a sudden there's a third person in there that I don't want to hear them talk.
The programmer? Yeah. Programmers are great, and they're smart, but you hate them, so you didn't want to talk to one. That's why you made a card game? Is that what I'm hearing?
It's really fun that I get to be the other person.
Because you, yeah, because the thing goes directly from idea to.
I get to talk to my wife. Can you believe it? I get to discuss things with my wife. No, she doesn't get to hear me talk to somebody else on Skype about
that
stuff.
That sounds lovely.
Yeah.
So what happened
it's helpful. It's helpful.
It's helpful and it's friendly. So what happened was you had this game. It was fun and it was good. And you call up the studio. You come back.
I call them up via email.
On your hands and knees, you dial their phone number on your email machine. Back. You crawled back.
I said, "You remember me?"
Through the tunnel of email.
Yeah.
And then it was just after that, it just suddenly came together, right?
Yeah. I mean, it came together, and then I contacted them, and then they were like, "Okay, let's do this." And then literally within 2 days, they were here at our house.
Oh man.
And it was like, "Oh, okay." And then they're like, "Let's play it." And it's like, "Okay."
They smelled that Isaac money.
Yeah. They got right up in there.
Yeah.
And they're like, "Okay, we're sending a film crew out next week. Let's strategize." And I'm like, "Okay, as long as it's not going to be like the other Kickstarter videos where there's somebody rehearsing lines, because I can't do that."
Yeah.
And they're like, "Well, we'll figure it out." And I'm like, "Okay." And then when the film crew came in, I just contacted straight up the director, the cinematographer. I was like, "Okay, I don't want this. Like, I don't want any rehearsed lines. I don't want anything like that. Just film me, and maybe we can get somebody to like ask me questions that I can respond to, kind of like this."
Yeah.
And that's what we did. It's like very genuine. It just felt like an interview. And then they filmed us playing the game and mocking each other, which came off really well in the trailer.
You see that? I watch a lot of Kickstarter videos. It's one of those things I actually genuinely like doing, is watching. I don't want to sound mean, but I like watching like bad Kickstarter videos.
Oh yeah, I had a few bookmarked that are pretty amazing.
I wish that there was just like an Apple TV app that would just let me, like a YouTube just for watching Kickstarter videos, you know, so I could just put them on a shuffle and just lol at them.
I wish I still had the link to the one. There was this, it was set in San Francisco.
Uh-huh.
It was they pitched it as a queer soap opera. It was like normal, except there was also a guy who was an assassin, and there was a guy who was like possessed. So it was like super, super over the top. And it almost seemed like a joke, because they would keep introducing new characters and showing what their like tagline was. And it just kept going and going and going and going and introducing more and more characters. And I would watch that a lot, and it's gone.
I got to say, that sounds great.
It was.
So, yeah, I like watching these Kickstarter videos. But, yeah, it does seem like a good idea to avoid a lot of the... I mean, a Kickstarter video is, like, very much a thing. It's like a genre of internet video at this point. So yeah. It's nice to avoid that. I've seen a little bit of yours.
What you saw, too, is me being so worried...
Yeah.
But there's the possibility of me saying, "This isn't going to work, cut it completely. I'm going to just animate something that kind of hopefully sells the game enough." And that's what I did. So the beginning of the trailer, there were two parts of it, and we ended up cutting off the how to play and putting it down in the how to play section.
Yeah.
But I animated like 3 minutes of nonsense in the style of the Binding of Isaac intro, and Matthias did the score for it and also the voiceover. Same guy from the Binding of Isaac.
Oh, yeah.
Technically Isaac's father.
Isaac's dad, Abraham.
Yeah.
Oh, I've read the Bible, okay? so let's talk about the game itself, how to play the game, right? Okay. So my number one question is this a tabletop game, or is it one of those card games that you play standing up? That's a joke, because those don't exist. I'm really proud of that joke. It's can you play this game standing up with no table? The answer is obviously no, right? That would be ridiculous.
No,
that'd be a mess. I'm sorry, I killed the momentum of the whole thing with my with my excellent joke. So it's a 4-player game, right?
Yeah.
Can you walk me through a game?
I can try. Okay.
You can try.
I can try.
Okay, let's hear it.
Imagine this. There are 3 decks of cards.
There's
a treasure deck.
Uh-huh.
It's full of a shitload of items that you know and love, and a few surprises.
Oh, wow.
Right? So there's a treasure deck.
You forgot to tell me to buckle up my seatbelt.
Buckle up, buddy.
All right.
Because I hope you're ready for what's coming next. The loot deck.
Oh, the LD. So wait, treasure deck and loot deck are different.
Oh, yeah.
Which one has more cards? The loot deck,
they both have 100.
Okay.
They all have 100.
Oh.
Well, that's not funny.
Easy to remember. Yeah. Easy to remember.
So the loot deck is the stuff that you would find usually on the ground when you complete a room in Isaac.
Yes.
So you've got shitloads of pennies, pills, hearts, tarot cards, and a bunch of other wacky shit. There's a lot going on there. The loot deck is your hidden information. Those are the cards that'll go into your hand that nobody kind of knows what it is. And then you've got the monster deck. And this is essentially going to simulate going room to room and fighting monsters.
Okay.
And then everybody takes a card from the player deck, which are the different characters in the game.
So wait, that's a fourth deck.
It's not really a deck. It's a handful of cards.
Oh, I see.
You can divvy them out. They get divvied out of a character card.
Do you pick them at random, or do you pick one?
Yeah,
you pick them
at random.
Okay.
It's better that way. I mean, I'm sure people will probably play a variant where they get to choose who they are, but it's way more fun to pick them. It feels more Isaac-y when you pick them at random.
Okay.
And each character starts with the same base stats. Except they each start with a very specific and unique starting item that makes them have a specific playstyle. So like Isaac has the D6, which allows him to re-roll any dice roll. Maggie has the Yum Heart, which allows her to reduce damage to her or to any other player. Kane actually manipulates the decks. He can look at the top three cards and put them back in any order of any of them. And then Judas can either raise or lower the dice result by one.
Interesting.
Which will make more sense in a second.
All right.
So once everybody has their character card, they each draw three loot cards. That's their hand. They take three pennies from the giant pile of pennies.
Pennies? There's pennies. A giant pile of pennies. So I need to stop you right there. I don't have any pennies at all in my house because I obsessively rid myself of change. So are you going to require me to have pennies? Am I going to have to go down to the corner store with a dollar bill and say, can I have 99 pennies and then keep one for yourself, buddy? Like, what do I have to do?
Get this.
Okay.
It comes with simulated pennies.
Simulated pennies?
You can't cash them in.
You can't ship real.
They're not like digitally simulated. They're, what's the word I'm looking
you
for?
Pretend they're there.
You pretend they're there. A bag of simulated
pennies. Imaginary pennies? No, wait. A bag of fake pennies.
A bag
of...
There you go.
Faux. You're counterfeiting U.S. currency. You're admitting to that, then.
Yeah.
Okay. Wait, what are these pennies made of? You can't just ship metal pennies. Did you know, fun fact, they don't have pennies in U.S. military bases in overseas, in Japan?
I feel like you're making this up as you go.
They're too expensive to ship. It costs more to ship 50 cents worth of pennies than, you know. I'm not even making this up. It's just not cost effective. Well, that's enough of that. Are your pennies, what are they made of? Are they made of cardboard? Because I don't want cardboard pennies getting banged up.
I believe that they're going to be plastic pennies. They're going to look like the pennies in the Binding of Isaac to the best of our ability.
You're going
to
have baby Isaac's face on there. There might even be a few.
No, it's going to have a scent symbol. That's it.
Okay.
And they're going to look like that.
A little sense.
There's going to probably be a nickel or two, maybe a dime.
Oh, so that you can have fives and tens.
Mm-hmm.
But mostly you probably like the visual of a whole bunch of pennies, because, right?
The pile of chaos.
Yeah. Anybody who's played a video game loves a pile of coins, right?
Yeah.
Of course. You know, we're all basically just dragons hoarding over a pile of gold in this life, right?
Yes.
Yeah, well, this got real dark and theoretical all of a sudden. So you've got pennies.
You've got pennies. You got three.
And you start with three. Okay,
you
so
start with three.
There's three decks: loot, monster, and treasure. Okay, and then there's a handful of character cards. There's four characters.
There's more than four characters.
There's more than four characters.
I don't want to spoil the fun right now.
All right, let's not spoil the fun. And there's four players. Each player takes a character card. And then each character has a treasure that is their treasure.
Yeah.
Right? And is that in the... What deck is that treasure in? Is that in the treasure deck?
No, it's a specific. It goes with the character deck. It's just a side.
Oh, okay.
It'll say on the card, like, you know, Judah starts with this, and it won't be in the treasure deck.
Okay.
It's unique to the character.
Yeah, unique treasures. Interesting. Okay, so you got your characters with the treasures, and they have pennies. You take 3 pennies when you take a character. You start with 3 pennies.
And 3 cards.
And 3 cards from loot?
Yep.
Okay, I'm on board now. Let us progress then.
So when the game starts, first you reveal the top 2 cards of the treasure deck, and you put them face up. That's the store.
Okay.
And then you take the 2 top cards of the monster deck and you put those face up, and those are the active monsters that are in the room that you guys are all in. That's the simulation.
Okay, wait, how many monsters?
2.
2 monsters.
You start with 2.
Okay. So there's 2 treasures face up, that's the store, and 2 monsters. All right. Yeah. All right, I'm ready to continue.
Now, during your turn, so the first, you know, usually Kane goes first, but if not, you're supposed to go with the saddest person in the room goes first.
That's funny.
Yeah, yeah. You gotta be funny in these Kickstarter card games.
Yeah, there's gotta be a joke somewhere.
there's gotta be something. But so during your turn, the first thing that you usually do is you reactivate or charge all your cards.
Okay.
So in case that they were activated previously, which usually means turning them sideways to show that they've become activated.
There's another card game that does that.
There is. Yeah. There is one. There's a few.
Oh, I know.
But yeah, there's no other good way to show that you've used the card, sadly. And, you know, you can flip them upside down, but then you wouldn't know what they are.
So turning them sideways to indicate activation, this requires that the players are facing each other?
Yeah, you're for the most part...
you don't have your backs turned or you're
not... You don't, yeah, you do have to see each other.
Okay.
And you have to see the cards.
Okay, that's enough of that joke then.
So... You reactivate your items, you draw 1 loot card for your turn, and then during your main phase, you choose to either, in any order, and you can do all these things, you can play a loot card from your hand in response to anything. It can be at any point during your turn. You can attack one of the monsters that are active, or you can actually attack the top of the deck, the unknown card that's on the top. You can be like, no, I'm just going to go for it. And then if you do that, you'd flip the top card over, put it over one of the active monsters, and then you're forced to interact with whatever is revealed. I'll go over combat since we're basically at that step.
All right.
So all the monsters, all the monsters in the game, they have little icons on them that show how much health they have, their hit dice, and their damage. The hit dice basically is like, oh, if it said 4+, that means when you attack this monster, you have to roll 4 or above on a 6-sided dice in order to deal your damage to the monster. If you miss, it deals its damage back to you. And all players start out with 2 life and deal 1 damage. That's the default setting for their stats.
Yeah.
You keep rolling until either the monster dies or you die. If you successfully kill the monster, you gain whatever reward is on the bottom of the card for killing it. If it's a basic monster, it'll be like, oh, you know, draw 2 loot cards, gain X coins or whatever else. And then that card goes into the discard pile. And if it was the last active card in the on the field, so let's say you had like 2 and you killed 1 of them, there's an empty active slot there. You have to reveal the top card of the library and pull a new monster into the room. And that's where things kind of get interesting, because not all the cards in the monster deck are monsters. Some of them are treasures. Some of them are chests. Some of them are curses. Some of them are trolley type things or stuff that just completely modifies how everything plays. And that resolves. Then during your turn, you can also purchase an item in the shop or purchase the top card of the item library that you don't, or the deck that you don't know what it could be, unless you're Kane, which you could probably see it.
Cause he can see the top 3
cards. Yeah. Cause he can modify decks. And those always cost 10 coins. And then you can end your turn. And if you end your turn and you happen to have 4 souls, which you gain souls by killing bosses, and they're just harder versions of the enemies that are more common in the game.
Okay, so bosses are in the monster deck.
Yeah.
Okay.
And if not, everybody heals. So you automatically heal and all their players heal. The monster heals and you pass to the next person and it keeps going around. Things get really interesting when you start interacting with something and you're like, oh, you know, I'm going to die. I just rolled a one and I'm going to die here. Isaac, can you use your dice to help me reroll this? So Isaac, okay, yes. Isaac rolls a three and rerolls a three. Oh shit. Well, it's a four plus and I'm still going to be dead here. Can Judas come in and modify this and turn it into a four so I can successfully kill it? Sure, but it'll cost you X coins. Or sure, but you're going to have to not fuck with me, you know, in the next couple turns or something along those lines. So you get a lot of cooperative barter in the beginning.
Yeah.
And then once people start inching closer to four souls, you see people start strategically shutting people down and locking people out or just purposefully screwing them over so they get killed. Because if you get killed, there's a penalty for death. You don't get removed from the game because that's no fun. Uh-huh. But you're forced to sacrifice a non-starting item. So, and discard a card and lose one penny. So there's a small penalty for death. And there's a lot of cards that can straight up like kill another player or stop them from doing a lot of different things. And things start comboing really well. And since there's like a progressive shop that you can see everything, you can strategize ahead and be like, okay, you know, I know I've got, you know, seven coins in my hand and a bomb, and I'm going to strategically play around this so I make sure that this guy doesn't gain enough coins to buy the card that I need so I can do it on my turn, or even cards that modify the cards that are in play and like switch them out and stuff like that to make it harder for other people to interact. There are also monsters that have progressive abilities that affect the board. So like whenever somebody activates an item, they take a damage, stuff like that. They're called cursed X, like cursed whore, yes. Cursed fatty. So you get some crazy situations that I have yet to like have the same game twice. It really feels like Isaac in that way too, where we played a game the other week where right off the bat there were two super difficult bosses, and that was it. It was like this wall of bosses. So people kept, you know, either bartering with Kane to like modify the top of the deck and give you information about what's on there so you could successfully kill things that are on the top that are smaller, or try to co-op together in order to kill one of these bosses, but not putting somebody in the lead. We've had games too where people like right off the bat get a shitload of souls because there's a lot of ways to like bend the rules and stuff with other cards. And right off the bat, everybody gets like two souls. So it's like, what's going on? And then it just gets super, super competitive. We've had games last like 15, 20 minutes. We've had games last over an hour. It's an ever-changing kind of game. It's pretty cool. I'm super happy with how like dynamic it feels when you're getting in it.
Yeah, it sounds like there's a whole lot. So I like hearing about this, how you can cooperate with your friends. So your friends might ask Kane to look at the deck to see what the next three cards are, and the Kane player may oblige and do that and then see the top three cards. But just because the Kane player has seen the top three cards doesn't mean they need to tell or be honest about it to the other three players.
Yeah.
Right?
And we've had situations too where the Kane player will set it up so, oh yeah, sure, you can attack the monster because it's easy, and they'll tell what it is, and it'll be truthful. But then he'll set it up so the next card's a treasure card, so he'll just attack the top card of the deck knowing it's a treasure card, get the treasure, and the next card will be a curse, but he won't tell anybody.
Yeah.
You know, it's just... And the other characters that I'm working on do a lot of pretty interesting stuff, too.
And this is why you don't let players choose their character.
Yeah.
Because then they'll be able to be in a certain mindset when they sit down to play.
Yeah, and you also might reward the player who's an asshole. We have a friend, his name is Jackson, and he likes to just cause chaos and troll everybody. And it's always a pain in the ass when he gets one of the more trolly characters, which there are a few of, because, you know, I want to compliment the players who do this, because sometimes having added chaos in the game is fun and helpful. I actually added and modded a lot of the cards in specifically for his playstyle.
Oh, wow. But
it always feels a little bad when somebody right off the bat gets something you know you're going to get fucked with. Like he had an item combo with Judas, the guy that can modify dice rolls, where he had another item that allowed him to reactivate one of his items whenever somebody rolled a two, And then he also had the Book of Belial, which allows you to raise or lower a dice roll by one. So if anybody rolled a one or a three, he would reduce it to a two and screw them over, and then also reactivate his book. So he would just have it. It's like he just had one, and one, two, and three were his numbers, and he locked them down. And if anybody rolled those numbers, he would just do whatever he wanted with them. That's... Of course, he became the target of every attack in the game, and everybody shut him out completely. But that's what he did, and he was there to fuck with everybody as they went.
Yeah, that's exactly the kind of person you actually need to play test your game when you're making a competitive game that relies on balance and cooperation and all that stuff.
And that was something I didn't even think about, because I'm not like that, and none of the other people that I knew were fit into that play style. But once he was there, it was very valuable, and I could complement his play style while still keeping it fun.
Yeah. So I feel like I know this game. So I feel like I know enough about it to sit down and play it if I had it before me and some people willing to play it. So Layers, you've got this monster deck. You call it the monster deck, but it's really kind of like the dungeon deck, right?
Yeah.
It's because it has not just monsters, but bosses and treasures in there as well.
Yeah.
Okay. So like, what percentage of the monster deck, this is, you know, my interest in math here. What percentage of the monster deck is bosses? What percentage is treasure?
It's 30% bosses. It's 10% miscellaneous, and the rest is monsters.
Okay. So yeah.
It's
miscellaneous is treasures and curses.
Miscellaneous is 20%.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah. That's it. Miscellaneous is 20%. It's 10% positive and 10% negative. So that's worth it. So it's a 10% treasures or 10% stuff that like could be bad. And then there's 30% bosses and then 50% monsters.
Excellent. So, okay, I think I've got this grasp. I think I have a complete grasp on the game and that I could sit down and play it and have a good time. All without looking at it. So that's fun. That's how you know it's a pretty good concept. Another question is, what percentage of the cards in the deck have turds on them? Like,
can you help me do the math?
Yeah, I'm pretty good at math. So
at least six of 300 and...
At least six.
At least six. I think there's a lot more than six, but...
It's a definite non-zero.
At least six.
What's the upper bound? At most what?
I could say 10.
At most 10? So at least six, at most 10?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's not
bad. And it's the Kickstarter's still going, so it's like I could change that up.
You can change up the turd percentage.
I think one of the tiers that we're doing, it's probably the highest tier, because I don't want to kill myself by drawing a million things. But one of them is I will make a hand-drawn, you know, prototype version custom card specifically for whoever wants it, and they can choose the theme. It could be themselves. It can be whatever else. So if somebody says turds,
yeah,
then I will draw more turds, but it's specifically for their game only. But
you should
it's
have
still there. You could back that like 10 times over, and I can do 10 custom turd items that are all different that you could actually put in your game and play with.
So that would wildly change up the percentage. Have you considered a Kickstarter pledge backer tier that will deliver you cards that are stained with real turds?
That'd probably be a little too funny.
Yeah, I guess so. What about? Okay, serious question again. What percentage of the cards have blood on them? Like, depict things that are bloody. Just off the ballpark me.
Okay, so Alejandro, one of the artists. So all the artists are also huge Isaac fans. I only commissioned artists that have like drawn shitloads of Isaac stuff. Crystal actually did majority of the trailers for all the expansions for Binding of Isaac as well. So he's great. And then Takara did all the art for the tarot card, limited edition tarot card decks that we put out. So she's amazing. But Alejandro's tends to draw lots of blood on his monsters. So majority of his stuff will have lots of blood. The other people draw kind of cuter, so less blood. I know there's a drop of blood as an item, bloodlust. That's bloody.
So you're saying most of the stuff has blood on it.
There's blood on it.
It's cartoon blood though, so it's mom friendly. Your mom.
Cartoon blood on naked children.
So in other words, if you have nobody else to play the game with, your mom will still be okay with it because it's cartoon blood.
Your mom will love it.
Your mom will just love it no matter what.
Their mom's in it.
It's all about moms.
Mom is being represented by a giant fucking leg.
Exactly. Okay, so now you're on Kickstarter. You got Kickstarter swag, right? Obviously, because that's the only reason you want to be on Kickstarters, because you just love giving people stuff, right?
Yeah.
So what's the stuff? What's the stuff you get for backing this stuff? Tell me a little bit about the stuff.
The stuff. There's a really cool playmat.
A playmat?
Yeah, it's a big one, too. It's supposed to simulate Isaac's bedroom, the ground in his bedroom. So it's like wooden planks and a trapdoor and then a bunch of functional stuff to help you play the game. There's cool posters. We're going to have some special guest artists that are pretty well known, and I won't reveal them yet, but a few that are like heroes of mine that are actually working on it. And they're going to do some prints or posters, but we'll definitely have some t-shirts, posters, and some official figurines.
Figurines?
Yeah, some toys.
That's exciting. Are you excited to have figurines of your own game?
Well, fuck yeah, I'm excited.
Custom dice?
Oh, custom dice, yeah. Custom dice.
Custom dice?
Yep.
That sounds nice.
Yeah. Okay. You can't, don't say that twice.
I mean, I think anybody who is...
I think I have lice.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, go, yeah. Go
anybody ahead. Who's a big fan of the game, which I feel like it's either like... I don't think there's anybody in, like, they're like, yeah, I kind of like that game.
That one guy on Facebook? It's like, whatever.
Who cares?
I don't care if it was a board game, whatever. Fucking card game, I don't know, whatever.
That's just because his mom already said, if this is a board game, I'm not playing it with you.
And then he tweets at me and kind of gives me the whatever as well. And he's like, just so you know, I don't care. And then I look at his pictures and it's like the same fucking picture of this guy's uncomfortable face over and over and over again. And I'm like, God. And then Warhammer stuff. And I'm like, dude, you fucking play tabletop games. What's wrong with you?
Oh, not that guy wants to be an army.
That guy. Fuck that guy.
That guy's wishing he was an army.
And I hope he hears and I hope he knows that I looked at his fucking pictures.
And they're stupid.
I think you're dumb, guy.
Oh, yeah. You just gotta love people on Twitter.
He
on
was
the internet.
Blonde. He was blonde.
Oh, what kind of grown man has blonde hair?
A blonde beard.
Ew.
I know.
Ugh. A blonde beard? Yep. I gotta admit, that sounds like the Minnesota Vikings. You know.
I was talking about his wife.
His It's okay to have a blonde beard. So you got people. I'm scrolling down a Twitter thread in which you.
Oh, did you find him?
A Twitter thread. I'm not going to look for the guy. I'm not going to find him. I see a forum thread on an internet forum where people are talking about this rumor that this game exists.
Yeah.
Oh, and. But somebody found the logo. Oh, and you posted the logo on Twitter.
Yeah, yeah. I made the mistake of saying the title.
Oh, now
I was like, I was laying down. I'm like, and I see this tweet. It's like, oh, Binding of Isaac, Four Souls. It's official. Confirmed. And there's a screenshot confirmed. I was like, what?
And then I hear from the other room. Did you say the title somewhere? I'm like, yeah.
She's like, I made the official Instagram and I put it there. I was like, well, no one knows what the title is. I've been blurring the title out.
Yeah, but yeah, the day before he kept telling me like, oh, they're figuring it out and that somebody has said Five Souls, and then he posted like the full art of something. So in my head I was like, oh yeah, that happened already.
Yeah. So I see people hear the Four Souls and they're thinking Zelda Four Swords. I see a couple of people. Oh man.
Some especially funny people are saying Dark Souls.
Yeah.
Oh, is it like Dark Souls? Is that what they're saying?
It's the Dark Souls of things in my house.
Oh, someone said WTF about it being a board/card game. So,
what the fuck?
No, I think it stands for what the fun.
Oh.
So they're very excited.
Finding the fun.
Finding the finding of Isaac's fun.
Yeah. The currency of cool.
Oh, yeah. There's always a currency of cool. You know what? I think that's enough. I think.
Are you just telling me to stop?
There are people listening to this right now instead of donating. Is it donating? It's not donating. Is it donating? It's not donating when the thing's like done. The funding. Instead of funding your Kickstarter.
Fun.
Instead of finding the funds.
Fun. Ding.
They're funding the fun.
Yeah.
Into the Kickstarter. Instead of doing that, they're listening to this. And we're basically contributing to the slower increase of the triumphant backing of your Kickstarter.
Get it while you can. You better get over there. I gotta put on my business hat and remember what they told me to say. You better get over and you better buy it and get it, because there's some limited things and you'll regret it. And I'll tell you from fucking experience, as somebody who funded the Kingdom Death Kickstarter, mm-hmm. and I was all about it, and I was like, oh, this looks really fucking cool. I believe in whatever they're talking about, and it looks like it's right up my alley. I'm gonna drop, you know, whatever it was, like $400 for that, for the standalone thing.
$400?
Yeah, and then it was like, for $100 more, you could get every fucking expansion for the game. And I'm like, fuck that. I'm not gonna do that. And then then they shipped it to me, and it's like the biggest goddamn box in the world, and I open it up, I'm like, this is amazing.
So
did I back the expansions? Because I hear those are cool, and I look online and it's like this giant fucking giant box of expansions.
Yeah, we've spent considerable money.
And it was like, what?
The things
can I get it? Nope, you can't get it. And then I go on fucking eBay, and each of the expansions, which like retail for like $50 to $60, it's like $400 each. It's like, come the fuck on. I paid that for that. Well, whatever. But don't be me, folks.
Yeah, fund it all the way.
Live and learn.
Fund it all day. Don't pay your rent.
Just put it in.
You can play the game on the street.
You can.
Right? You don't have to play it in a house. So in the interest of appearing unbiased, I now have to say, don't kickstart it, please. If you really, really want to, do it. However, I'm not advising anyone to do that. I really don't think they should. Because I think
that'll be the quote.
I think
the
they should just
headline.
Go to
and then people will poach that story.
Go to your friend's house. Play it on, you know. Play it on the street in front of your friend's house.
Just pirate it.
Ah, so that's the real reason you're making a card game, is you don't want people to pirate it.
No, they can still pirate it. I did.
Oh, you pirated.
Technically, right?
Go down to Kinko's and have a drunk employee.
You can put the work
to print it for you. Yeah, you got to deal with the guy at Kinko's who's drinking on the job. Drinkos, if you want to pirate it, right? So you don't do that. Get it from the source, and you are the source. Is that true?
I don't know anymore.
Yeah, I think I gotta go home.
I was gonna add, when you were talking about getting a job.
Yeah.
My only involvement with Kotaku before this. Did I say it right? Kotaku.
I believe there's a proper pronunciation. It's supposed to be like a Japanese word, but I don't hear too many people stick to it, so it's okay.
Well, somebody had posted. I got a Jigglypuff tattoo.
Yeah.
On my arm in maybe 2011, and somebody posted it on there.
It was like an article about tattoos. It was like an official thing, and her thing's right there.
One of the comments was, "Good luck getting a job, dude."